majoritarian state, you know, having an identity which actually reflects the majority syndrome, not so much of the minority. And this is not very specific to any countries. I think it is one sees this across South Asia. For example, whether it is in Sri Lanka, the Sinhala-dominated polity tried to define politics on the manner in which the dominant Sinhala communities do, and also at the same time, in the context of Nepal, the, you know, the politics of Hill versus the Tarai. In Pakistan, it is, though it is an Islamic state, which version of Islam is dominant, and the narrative which is geared towards the same. Also in the context of Bhutan, which is again the Drukpa politics, which saw the southern part of the Bhutan, which was basically you know, the southern Bhutanese, or the Lhotshampa said at one point of time was seen as a kind of a threatening to the larger Drukpa identity. So, and similarly in India, you also see the rise of the right-wing politics in terms of the Hindu nationalism, who feels that since they are the majority in the country, so the identity has to reflect the majoritarian impulse. So what? So here it is not, you know, and all this majoritarian impulse actually try to frame an identity where the many of the minority groups actually feel marginalized. So when you get marginalized, it is not actually confined to the politics. This also is later reflected in the economic policies of employment, and policies of giving primacy to the language. In the context of Bangladesh during the Pakistan time, one also witnessed the same kind of primacy which was attributed to Urdu at one point of time, and the same also continues in Pakistan. So therefore, when the marginalization happens, so the smaller ethnic group, or the group which feel that, you know, they actually do not figure in the state structure, they tend to, you know, feel aggrieved. And this marginalization is sometimes politically constructed, and narratives are accordingly constructed. So the narrative becomes we versus them. So initially, most of the places where you know, the movement starts as a kind of, you know, asking for larger rights of a group which feels marginalized in the state structure, it slowly, if it is not addressed, takes the form of violent extremism. Sometimes it may result in violence, sometimes it has the potential which can be flared up any time with the government, or, you know, any particular group wants to play it on. One saw this in the context of Sri Lanka, the ATT violence, which was actually grew out of this politics of marginalization, where not only the language, you know, they felt that the language was not part of the state identity because of the Sinhala-only policy in 1956, but later, because of the primacy of the national language, actually did not allow them to get jobs. So there was this introduction of quota system, which slowly marginalized the Tamil community in Sri Lanka. That is just one example. There are many. Similarly, in the context of Pakistan, if you look at the MQM, Mujahid Qawami movement, at one point of time, they were seen as the people who actually dominated the politics. But the Sindhis started looking at the Mujahid from the perspective of that they have become a dominant community. So then again, there was a quota system which was introduced. So you have this kind of instances across South Asia, which actually fits into the sense of marginalization. Similarly, also, you know, some these narratives are constructed to, you know, in a sense, to reflect a particular kind of identity. I think some of the times what happens is that it is based on some real political and economic grievances. Sometimes it may be perceived, but that does not mean that such grievances does not exist. Maybe the intensity of the grievance is not, you know, varies from one person to the other person. So that is where the narratives becomes very, very significant. And this narrative is constructed in a such a manner that it tries to project a particular community as us, if I belong to that group community, versus they. They means the ruling elite or the dominant political elite belonging to a particular ethnic community who dominates. And this, over the period of time, if not addressed by the youth, you know, actually adds to the grievances and which actually may lead to violent extremism. Now, I give an example in the context of, again coming to Sri Lanka, in the context of Sri Lanka, if you have looked at the JVP violence, which was in the 1970s, which is a major cause of concern, which again, you know, started with the Tamil violence on the northern side. And the JVP violence actually oriented itself in a much more left kind of ideology, where it feels that, you know, the state actually does not take into account the interest of the large, you know, proletariat class, a large working class, and it has become an embodiment of the elite. So that is where, you know, this entire movement started ideologically in the 1970s in Sri Lanka. Similar instances of left radicalism is also present in, was present in Nepal, which again is a very successful case of, you know, political transition of from the radical left to the political mainstreaming, which has not happened anywhere in South Asia, probably a very, very unique instance in the entire subcontinent. So, and also at the same time, when you look at, you know, the issue in Pakistan, if you remember the Rawalpindi conspiracy case, it also grew out of a kind of, you know, left-oriented ideology, where it was seen the ruling elite actually is not taking the interest of the state into account. And of course, you know, Bangladesh is also not aligned to, you know, the left kind of the radical left in the term of Jasod, which soon after the independence threatened the stability of the state. Now, I think in the 60s and 70s, the radical politics was much more ideologically oriented, but also at the same time it had certain nuances. I think by the 80s, most of this radical politics transformed itself into terrorist groups or, you know, violent you know, extremist groups, which was not hesitant to take violence into the hand. The one of the reasons could be the manner in which the state in each of the South Asian countries dealt with this issue of the radicalization and extremism. That contributed to basically, I would say, the youth radicalization. And similarly, if you look at the leadership of the, you know, of the left groups or, you know, the ethnic groups in the past, they were much more, you know, while except for LTT, while they were fighting for their rights, they were also amenable to negotiate, which is not happening now. Now you see a very new group of people which has come up, where there is no scope of negotiation. Like, for example, earlier, for example, the insurgent groups, whom the state could actually bring to the negotiating table. In the context of India, I would say in the Northeast, many of the insurgent groups which are at that point of time were functioning, some of them were actually resolved through negotiation. The Mizo National Front is one of the, again, a successful case, like the case of the Maoists in Nepal, where they were mainstream. And the former insurgent leader became the chief minister of that particular state. So that is again a successful case of accommodation. Similarly, in the context of the CHT, you know, because of the CST Accord, though of course, you know, there are certain disconcerting note regarding the manner in which the effort has been implemented, but nevertheless, at least to a very large extent, you know, that accommodated some of the grievances at one point in time, which was held by, you know, people in the CHT. I'm just giving, you know, these are not very, you know, not even some of the successful cases. And similarly, if you look at, you know, in the context of India also, when I speak of the youth radicalization, earlier, like, I'll give an example from Kashmir, because in the recent past, you will see, you know, those people who were involved in violence mostly constituted the age group of, you know, 12 to 15, and some of the time, you really do not know how to deal with them. And here also, what has happened, the older leadership, which actually, in a manner, who could be at least engaged by the state, even if not, even though not all the groups were willing to speak to the Indian state, but at least some of the groups are willing, Now the younger generation, they do not have any vision of actually what they want. You know, they want the extreme or zero. So between the zero and the extreme, when you negotiate, there is no in-between point. At least when the older generation used to negotiate, even if you negotiate for the maximum, there is a minimum point where, you know, at least, you know, there used to be a settlement. So you are actually facing a kind of extremism, that of ethnicity, that of identity, that of language, which actually is not willing to negotiate. Because, like, another example I give of the Taliban-Pakistan, where again, like, Shafqat was speaking of the failure of the Western democracy. Now, this has become a very, a kind of, you know, very, very familiar kind of phrase for many of the extremist groups which are operating within South Asia, especially the ideological group. If the left group says the democracy is actually the embodiment of the bourgeois politics, similarly, the TTP, it says that it is the failure of the Western democracy. So their narrative is constructed in a very different fashion. Like, for example, the religious political parties, which are functioning in, you know, many of the South Asian countries, were willing to participate in, you know, in any kind of election. You know, they were, if you speak to the leaders of religious political parties, they felt that participating in the politics, entering into the politics, they might bring in the change. Now the younger lot, they don't have the, you know, as in political sense, you use bottom-up approach. Now it is a top-down approach. Capture the state power and then, you know, bring in the kind of ideology or bring in the your vision of the state, implement your vision of state. The same is the case with the TTP, same is the case with the JMB or the Neo-JMB, where the capturing of the state becomes much more significant. And also at the same time, the governance factor in democracy, the slowness of the judiciary in dispensing justice becomes a kind of, you know, contrasting factor with those people who want a radical revision of the state. For them, the, you know, justice can be dispensed within the tribal, kind of society within probably, you know, 2 hours. The same kind of thing does not happen with the state. Here you have access to the justice in terms of you don't pay so much of money, the tribal elders come and they decide a case, but you don't see the normal judicial process. So as a result, you know, the contrasting feature of the Western democracy and the democracy or the, you know, system of governance which many of the extremist groups, especially the radical left and the radical right, are propagating, actually will make the propaganda of the left and the right much more appealing to a common man who actually does not have much stake in the system. You know, they don't benefit except for one vote in some of the time, and especially in the context of Pakistan, many of the places which is again dominated by the Jamindars, there, you know, the voting is decided by the person for whom you are voting, unlike many of the countries in South India. So here, you know, the notion of democracy actually, or even the power of, you know, the empowering structure of the nation state actually have not percolated to the general masses, who have in fact become vote bank in many of the countries. So therefore, the extremist ideology of changing the society, radically changing the society, radically changing the state, actually finds many takers among these people. Of course, here I'm not speaking of the politically indoctrinated or ideologically indoctrinated, educated mass. You know, that is a very different kind of problem. Shafqat was speaking of, you know, Hizbul Tahrir. You know, how do you deal with the urban educated radicalization? I think you would need a very, very different process. So many times, probably in our kind of society, generally in many of the discussion, you tend to hear that actually it is the poor people who do it for money and all. But I think in the recent past, it has been proved. And, you know, what has happened is that, you know, the urban youth radicalization has happened. Though in the context of both TTP and also in the context of the Maoists in Nepal, the foot soldiers are definitely not as educated and much more poorer. So of course, again, you know, the foot soldier and the leadership, again, you know, if like for in the context of Nepal, you see the leadership is completely Brahmin, but the foot soldier is mostly from the real marginalized people. So I was not surprised when the marginal people, you know, start asking that, is this the state they asked for? So therefore, the growth of radical politics, I would say, has become much more appealing in the state which has more democracy. I would say, because recently I saw one article regarding this, you know, the few of the independent movement in Spain, in Italy. So I saw, you know, the Hong Kong, you know, the movement in Hong Kong, whether that will get any kind of space to manifest in a manner in which this separatist movement manifested both in Spain and also in Italy. And this person, I found it very, very interesting, because this person argues what democracy does is it provides you the space. Whether you like it or not, it provides that space. So therefore, the author's argument was that given the Chinese system, the Hong Kong, you know, demonstration may not have the same kind of latitude as one saw in Spain and Italy. Then the lack of political settlement, and I will come to that, how the state has actually, you know, dealt with some of these, you know, some of these groups. There is this, you know, when the violent extremism, it reaches the stages of violent extremism, many of the time the state deals with, you know, these groups as a law and order problem, whereas they're not actually law and order problem. They probably need a much more comprehensive approach. They're just a law and order problem. The law and order only ensured the group's participation in the negotiating table, because, like, for example, in the context of Sri Lanka, when the LTT became very invincible, that point of time, many of the, you know, not just the Sri Lankan government, but many of the government across the world thought elimination of LTT is actually prior requirement for a peaceful settlement of the Tamil crisis in Sri Lanka. So, but again, you know, the issue having been, you know, the LTT being eliminated in the war, the political settlement is completely lacking. So here, why? Because, you know, in any kind of conflict, if the state wins, the state actually loses its interest to resolve, you know, most of the conflict politically. The approach is just completely law and order, and you don't have a post-conflict reconstruction or post-conflict scenario where you can take the peace further by entering into a kind of political settlement. And that actually gives rise again to this kind of extremist feeling. And the only example I can give is of Sri Lanka, where when you go to the northern part of Sri Lanka, especially the Tamil-dominated area, there is this feeling of despondency. And many of the Tamil groups were actually not supportive of the LTT, and after the 2009, they thought they are actually liberated from the grip of such a radical organization. Now slowly the sympathy for the LTT is growing. Because again, why? Because it is linked to the honor. Like, for example, many of the Tamils explained it to me that when the LTT was there, they were not questioned by the Sri Lankan army, or they were not shadowed, they were not asked questions. When they go to the, you know, to Colombo and other places. So somehow they're trying to, you know, link the terrorist group as a group which actually ensured the honor of the Tamils. You know, so I feel, you know, this, you are entering into a very dangerous kind of scenario where the political settlements prolongs and you don't see any kind of settlement. And you also do not see any kind of step which is sincerely being taken by the government. Though I agree with the change of government in Sri Lanka, there are certain steps which has been taken. In the context of Nepal, of course, you know, the thing is that with the political transformation of the Maoist, at least even if the, you know, the peace process prolonged for a very long time till they had the constitution, at least you see some action, you know, happening, even if it is, you know, I know many of my friends in Nepal felt very frustrated by, you know, this lengthy political process, but nevertheless, there was something happening, which is not, when you look at in the context of Sri Lanka. And similarly, in the context of India, with the Maoist, I think India has taken this stand. It has, though there was this mechanism of applying force, but also at the same time, you know, there is this negotiation which has not even started, because the Maoist group which is fighting in Bastar, part of Orissa and Bihar, actually are not in a position to give up. So here what the government position or the government action is very, very different in terms of having a kind of incisive actions in particular place and trying to bring the development into the areas which were, you know, completely isolated, but also at the same time extracting the minerals. You know, so the local population, see, you take the minerals and you profit from the minerals in those areas, yet there is no development which happens in those areas. So this is also another major cause of grievance in India. Then, of course, I have already spoken about how marginalization of moderate actors have happened. And therefore, you know, violent extremism becomes a political strategy. Because, you know, then suppose I'm fighting for a cause and I'm not able to be, not able to actually see the resolution of certain political grievances. So you move towards, then you have a justification that the method which you have been adopting for a long time has failed. Therefore, you get into the violent extremism. And the narratives are already there. You don't have to construct the narrative. And these narratives, like for example, like I just been to Kashmir, and whenever you speak to the Kashmiris, I try to tease them that anything which happens between the state, within the state, the people tend to blame the central government, not the state government. So I was telling them that blame your government first, and second, blame Delhi, because your government is profiting by putting all the blame in the center and not acting. But the thing is, it becomes very easy. Like, for example, in the violent area, it is very easily people will brand you as the government agent if you speak sane, or if you want to speak up resolution when nobody wants to, you know, people want to carry on their fight. So this kind of context sometimes becomes extremely difficult, sustaining a narrative which actually, you know, there is no other counter-narrative. Because with the violent narrative, you really don't have an alternative to show, okay, you know, the state has offered you 1, 2, 3, the state has accommodated you, or the state is willing to negotiate with you. And what is the parameter of the negotiation? Because if you're not sincere in your negotiation, it will just, you know, it is a kind of thing, stopgap arrangement, I would say. Like, for example, in the context of Kashmir, many Kashmiris see that central government offer of negotiation is a stopgap arrangement, not actually intend to resolve the conflict, which is larger, which has a, you know, both international and a domestic problem. But domestically, I feel at least India should be able to deal with that conflict within the domestic sphere and, you know, forget the bilateral and the international dimension to it. So therefore, the credibility of the actor, you know, who can bring the peace, who can take the dialogue further, actually lacking in most of the countries in South Asia. The same is also in the case of Pakistan and Balochistan. The credibility, if the credibility of state, if the state loses its credibility, then these groups who are actually speaking of violent extremism find a kind of justification in continuing what they are continuing. Very quickly, when you want to speak of shared landscape, here you are actually speaking of transnational network, which actually is not very much confined to the region, it goes beyond. You know, it goes, like, for example, in the context of some of the groups like, you know, LET or, you know, the JNB, or in the context of India, the Indian Mujahideen, or in the context of the Nepali Maoist, you know, having linkages with the Maoist in India, and the Maoist in India think that the Nepal Maoist were actually not a fruitful movement, and so you have this transnational linkages. So even if something happens domestically, it is not confined to that state or the LTT. You know, for example, they not only initially, even if they started from India, they had an international network. So how do you deal with this international network? Actually will tell you, you know, what kind of threat it is. Similarly, I would say, you know, the threat landscape actually includes instability, and it has larger economic implications. Shafqat was speaking of the, you know, the Gulshan attack and the kind of economic implications it had. Similarly, in the context of the Mumbai attack, it had a larger economic implications, because many of the people were not very comfortable to travel at that point of time. Especially most, because we are looking at the investors here, but mostly Western countries, you know, it is not South Asia. Like for an Indian coming to Bangladesh, even during the Gulshan attack, I don't think, even because I stayed there at that point of time, I was not scared. But for a Western country, I'm saying that, you know, traditionally, wearing, no, like, example, you know, if you go out of your house, you know, you are going to return. Like, some of the time when the Western friends of mine say that, oh, you know, there will be a war. So I always tell them that we Indians, you know, there are many reasons to die. You can die on the road, in a road accident. So why should you wait for a war to happen to get to die? You know, because, you know, we speak a very different kind of threat.
There are so many ways to die. There are so many easy ways to die.
Yes. So therefore, you know, because since we are looking for investment, which comes most from the Western sources, so any kind of instability in a country actually does not provide, the, you know, if you look at the investment indicators of all the countries, it actually goes down. So that creates a problem. Then most of the, in spite of, you know, speaking of a majoritarian state in most of the countries, you have a particular community which is a majority, but all the countries are pluralistic countries. You know, we tend to forget that. We don't recognize that there are many other groups speaking different languages, belonging to different religion, belonging to different ethnicity, live in this country. So these kind of, incidents where the violent extremist narrative tried to project one group against the other, it actually affects the social fabric. And, you know, the social fabric takes centuries to build. And one cannot afford to, you know, to destroy the social fabric by not countering the violent extremist, ideology and the factors which fuels this ideology. Yes, the ideology exists, but the continuation of ideology is due to various, act or not acting of the government. Then, of course, the security implications in terms of the spectrum of the threat are really, really vast, you know. It is, Shafqat in the morning spoke about it, I'm not going to speak, because most of the countries the threat spectrum is same, it is not different. Now, mapping the threat landscape, I will finish this very completely. Of course, the ideological foundation to violent extremism and the justification of violence, whether you take in terms of religion, you know, you can use, like for example, certain verses of Quran to say that, okay, this is justified. Similarly, ethnically or linguistic-wise, you also can justify your violence. Same is in the context of other religion also, where you have the justification to engage in a kind of violence. But then again, I think most of the violence need not have to be religiously sanctified. You don't need that sanctification. You have grievances which is actually lingering over a period of time. Then you have the justification for taking into arms, because you don't see any other way of resolving the conflict. So that could be one of the reasons, because most of the incidents are very, very long run, especially in India's northeast, Balochistan, similarly the Afghanistan, and also the Tamil issue, which are very, very old. I don't think Nepal has that problem of old. Yes, the grievances in Tarai is old, but then again, I really do not believe that it will take the extremist stand, though some of them they claim that they will take on arms and that kind of thing. And also the spread of extremism across the region. Here I gave individual case studies I have already spoken. Now, you know, it is not that you are aggrieved. Like for example, some of the time what happens in Southeast Asia is that a particular attack, like I'll give an example of an attack on, I think in the some of the people who were killed in Assam flood, and then, you know, there was this fear, and you know, which had repercussion in Mumbai, where people actually gathered to say that, you know, the Assamese Muslims are killed by the ethnic Assamese, you know, the Bodos, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Similarly, in the context of, you know, an attack on some of the Biharis in the train, took the proportion of a kind of ethnic conflict where the Assamese were very scared, and all of most of them then left from Bangalore and went back to the state. So, you know, this kind of small incident, because of the Facebook, spreads so wide, and then again you don't have a faith in the state system to be so proactive and to take action. So the first thing as a human being is that you want to protect yourself. You don't want the police to come and go out thinking that nothing is going to happen, because, you know, that has been the case in the entire South Asia. So the spread of extremism across the region, and in some cases you also have the linkages. Like I said, you know, the linkages are not very much confined to South Asia. It goes beyond the region. within South Asia, of course, you know, I'll come to the institutional, responses of the state. I think, as I said, you know, the approach of the state is always law and order. If you have any problem, okay, call the police, call the, you know, the, for example, the RAP in the Bangladesh context, in the context of India, the CRPF. So, you know, the approach is law enforcing. Okay, maybe in the first instance you need that law enforcing, but after the law is enforced, what next? There's no next. Because till the next incident happens, the state does not act. So I think that all actually becomes a little problematic if you don't have a comprehensive approach to any kind of, you know, marginalization, which actually leads to radicalization. And some of the time the state overreacts, arresting people. Like some of the time, you know, I have seen, you know, once when I lost the mobile phone, the police will say that which area you have to say. You know, initially when you were a student, you didn't know, so you used to say, okay, I lost it there, okay, go to that police station. Now since, you know, we have gone through this, so you, whatever the police station is nearest, you know you are not going to get it. But you want another SIM card, so you need to, you know, register for the FI, you say that, okay, I lost it only here. So you registered the, you know, the this thing. And I remember once when I went to the police station, I told them that my mobile was stolen. The policeman was telling that, no, you say lost. I said, no, lost is my responsibility, stolen is your responsibility. So you put stolen. Now you won't be able to go to the court and all. So, you know, this kind of thing, I'm just giving a case of the mobile. But this is what happens, you know, unnecessarily, like suppose each police station has to show that how many cases have been registered and how many cases have been resolved. So sometimes what happens, unnecessarily you go and arrest an innocent person saying that this person is actually the person who is behind the crime. Like I saw today, I was reading one of the very interesting editorial which has come in the Indian Express regarding the Ryan International student who was killed. Initially they arrested the, the bus conductor. Because, you know, he is poor, so the elite started thinking, okay, he is a guy who is very much prone to crime. We can't commit any kind of crime. So when somebody's son is arrested, who is a senior in that school, who actually killed the person, the same kind of voice is missing. Nobody says, okay, hang him, or, you know, give him sentence. Now you see the absence, you know, how mentally we look at, you know, the person who commits the crime. And same is the case, like in the context of India, many times there are people against whom the name, you know, the cases have been filed, have found, you know, they have exonerated by the judiciary. So what happens to that missing year when he was in jail? So won't he take to the extremism, only take, take up arms? So I will not be surprised. And this is, I'm just giving an example of in India, where many of the time the debate is that in many places some of the Muslims have been arrested and in many cases they have been found innocent. Whether they did it or not is a different issue. It also depends on the kind of investigation. But when the person is exonerated, the person has lost many, many years. So if that person takes up, and if the state acts so irresponsibly, or especially the law enforcement agencies act so irresponsibly, then nobody is able to answer to compensate. You know, some of the time I feel that the person who actually finally is found to be innocent should go and file a case and ask the state to compensate for the years and the name, you know, finding in our kind of society, each time you look for a government job, so they will go and find out, okay, whether you have any registered any cases or not. So therefore, I think our approach should move beyond law and order. Then also coming to the reason, I think that is lack of regional institutional approach. You have definitely the SARC is there, like speaking in the morning that there is a police training thing which is happening in Bangladesh for all the South Asian countries, which is very, very interesting. So therefore, you know, if you don't have an institutional approach, then it becomes one of the kind. I am in power, I think this is great, so I will move with this. So next time somebody else is power, he or she may think, so this is not great, this is wastage of money. So the institutional approach will ensure continuity. And the violent extremism which was seen within our region, I think we need to actually learn from each other and unlearn those components which actually does not lead to a fruitful kind of solution of any kind of conflict. So therefore, I think in South Asia, everything we have, I think, like for example, you have like you have Jamaat-ul-Mujahideen in Bangladesh, you have ISIS South Asia branch. So you know, look at the law enforcing agencies. You really, you know, you're fighting within the country without any kind of intelligence input or cooperation from the other side. So how do you deal with the groups who are much more sufficient in terms of the identity, in terms of the collaboration, in terms of the network they have? So if you're not replicating the militant or the extremist network in terms of countering the propaganda, and the militant network having, you know, countering it with a similar kind of, you know, network of intelligence of and the network of the law enforcement agencies, I really don't think you can beat them. Of course, the bilateral institutional mechanism is there. One of the successful cases has been the Burman blast, where there has been a lot of intelligence sharing. My only point is that can we have an institutional arrangement, not a not an arrangement which is based on an incident. So it should not be an incident-based arrangement. Okay, this is the incident which happened, so we feel that there are some people who are hiding on this side or that side, so therefore we must collaborate. Why not have an institutional mechanism, even if it is bilateral, because within South Asia it may be difficult. By aiming at having a regional institutional mechanism, but bilaterally it can start, it has to start somewhere. I think there is always a state-centric approach to violent extremism or any kind of crisis. You know, most of us, like for example, one day, again, bringing my experience from reading one particular article, I'm just forgetting the author's name, very renowned author. He said that, where is the state? For the middle class and the rich class, the state is not there. Want electricity, have generator, don't have water, buy the mineral water. For whom the state exists? It's for the poor people. Now you go to the slum, electricity is not there. So who is going to give it? They will say, government. You won't have any other, they will not partner any other one. Who will give you water? Government. Will give you electricity? Government. So therefore, I think rather than having a state-centric approach, because I do understand at that level you may have a state-centric approach, where the state need to intervene, I think we really have the lack of civil society engagement. Because most of the government feel that the civil society is unnecessary, and we almost tend to dismiss, you don't know anything. I was in the investigation, I know it, so you don't know it. I think probably the capacity of the state to hear the voices which may not be present will be significant in countering this kind of change. So I will end my presentation here, and if there is any questions across, you can speak in Bangla, I will reply in Bangla.
Excuse me, madam.
We'll go one by one, please. Thank you so much for your presentation. I think you gave us plenty of food for thought. And what I particularly enjoyed about your presentation, that you looked at it from a political science and a social science perspective, not just from a purely security perspective. Because I think quite often we tend to forget that terrorism is ultimately a means to an end. And more often than not, the goals are either political or there is a certain socio-economic aspect attached to it. So I think the way you sort of looked at marginalization, majoritarian politics, issues of pluralism, I thought that was very good. You touched upon a very important issue about need to institutionalize bilateral cooperation. I think that is very cool. At the moment, we have some excellent cooperation mechanisms in existence between India and Bangladesh. And I think there is an opportunity to strengthen it even further, because we must recognize that the threat that Bangladesh faces in a way affects India and vice versa. Because I think the groups have an opportunity, because of the porous nature of our borders, to operate from both sides of the border. And we need your cooperation very much in order to solve this problem. With that, I would suggest that we take a short break for tea, and then we will come back for 10 minutes for Q&A. We will have more than an hour for Q&A, so everybody's voice can be heard. Thank you.